If we think about future society, we often think about it being populated not just by human intelligence, but also by computer intelligence. That's what science fiction shows us. Many science fiction movies show us intelligent machines that we can communicate with and that are just as smart or even smarter than people. But this is really the future. Well, if you read the newspapers, you're going to think that it is, because we see in the news all the time more news about smart machines and machines getting smarter and predictions that we're on the verge of machine intelligence. Now, I'm going to tell you today that we're not that far yet, and I'll also explain to you why. So let's look at a couple of triumphs of artificial intelligence. So in 1997 already, the world champion in chess was no longer a human, but a machine. Deep Blue from IBM beat Kasparov at chess. That's already almost 20 years ago. And it took almost those 20 years to become a world champion in Go for a computer. And that happened earlier this year. And there's a lot of talk about self-driving cars. And maybe in 10 years' time, our roads will be populated by self-driving cars instead of human drivers. So is that a new development in artificial intelligence? Is the intelligent computer really there? I'm going to argue it's not, and I'm going to demonstrate this with a very simple game. It's a game I'm going to explain to you in just, 20 seconds or so. It's the game of memory that we hopefully all know. You turn over cards and you find matching pictures, but instead of pictures, this time there are equations on the other side. So you have to find two cards where the solution to the equation is the same. So I'm going to start. So I'm turning over the first card, 2x equals 10. So I'm going to solve that. And I turn over a second card. And all right, as you see that equation. So that's not a match, right? Everyone following along? Because now it's your turn. Turn over these two. I'll turn over the first one for you. So what's the next card? Anyone? Yeah, you.
Top left.
All right. Matching pair. You don't see the same picture, but you do see the same answer. Now, hopefully, everyone was following along, because what I just showed you is something that computers cannot do yet and are not even near being able to do. Because I just taught you a new game that you've never played before, unless you were in the subject of my experiments. And you could play it. You could play it straight away. And that doesn't seem like much of a miracle, right? You think like, well, we know how to play memory. We know how to solve equations, hopefully. So we can play this game. So why is this so interesting? So let's look at the two champions I mentioned earlier, Deep Blue, who beat Kasparov at chess, and AlphaGo, who beat Lee Sedol at Go. They're marvelous machines. And Deep Blue was sort of, so if you look at Deep Blue, it's fully programmed to play chess. It was actually fully programmed to beat Kasparov even. But it cannot do anything else. It can only play chess. It cannot even do anything that's remotely like chess. The same is true for AlphaGo. It can only play Go. Well, AlphaGo has one sort of great novelty, and that is that it taught much of the knowledge itself. So it trained itself to become better at Go. So that you could say that's already a step forward. But still, AlphaGo, with all its knowledge, cannot play any other game unless you start completely from scratch again. Now, this is very, very different from how humans collect their knowledge. So let me tell you a little bit my personal history of learning chess. When I was a small child, I saw a chess set at my grandfather's place. And I want to say, like, hey, I want to learn chess. And he said, like, no, that's too difficult for you. My grandfather was a bit of a grumpy guy, but so if you sort of analyze how I learned chess, sort of I started sort of playing with other children, and with other children you sort of know about giving and taking turns, knowing that the other wants something else too. And then I moved on to sort of more formal games, but games where it's all luck, but you still have to adhere to the rules, you have to take turns. And then I moved on maybe to checkers. And eventually, I learned chess, and even more eventually, I beat my grandfather at it, which was sort of the final triumph. But what we see here is that we build up knowledge step by step. We start with sort of interacting with other humans, thinking about other humans. We then learn to play by formal games. Then strategy comes in, and then finally we can learn to play the complex games. There's no computer that does that yet. They all sort of focus on just on one thing. They learn chess from scratch or play chess from scratch. No human can ever do that. So, well, I'm a professor of artificial intelligence, but I'm really interested in how humans learn. So I'm going to show you a little bit of my research. So if we think about learning and about knowledge, usually we think about knowledge of facts, things like 3 + 2 = 5 or birds can fly. But a lot of our knowledge is about how we do things. So if you learn multi-column addition in school, you learn a sort of procedure on how to do that, how to add up columns, how to handle carries, how to write down the answer. That's what we call procedural knowledge, knowledge on how to do things. It's also like how to eat with knife and fork, which is probably knowledge that is hard to vocalize for us, but it's something we can do and we picked up at some point. But it's a very, very, very complex motor skill. So I try to analyze that kind of knowledge. Now, there's a lot of work on knowledge for facts. So if we learn 3 + 2 = 5, what we do is we connect concepts that we already have. So we connect 3, 2, and 5 together into a new memory trace that stores like, well, that's addition. That's the addition of 3 + 2. But our knowledge of how we do things, we can consider that in the same way as sort of pieces of knowledge in our memories. So we might have knowledge on how to handle the carry in a multi-column addition. It's something that if the answer that you have is greater than 10, greater or equal than 10, then you have to remember that there will be a carry in the next column. That might be a piece of knowledge that you need to learn. Now we can analyze many things we do in terms of these pieces of knowledge. So if we have the whole knowledge that you need for multi-column addition, you get a graph like this, and this is part of the results of our analysis. And what you see here is that we have, and I marked some of the nodes where you say, like, well, there is a part that where you retrieve an arithmetic fact, what's the addition of 3 + 2, checking carries, writing down answers, moving from one column to the other, and all these little circles are sort of small information processing steps, like put something in your working memory, look at something on the paper, write down something on a sheet of paper. And so this is what you need to learn, all these little circles, all these little nodes, in order to be able to do multi-column addition. So that's a piece of knowledge that we, in some fashion, have in our heads. Now, if I look at another problem, multi-column multiplication, that's a more complex problem. So you see lots of more nodes. That is just very hard to learn completely from scratch. That's very hard for humans to just learn out of the blue. But fortunately, we don't have to do that because we already have our prior knowledge. We can start with multi-column addition and then learn multi-column multiplication on top of that. So if we look at the overlap between these two networks here, we have a lot of overlap. So all the yellow halos that you see here are nodes that are shared between multi-column addition and multi-column multiplication. So here we have some sort of general skill about handling arithmetic in columns that is useful for multiple types of problems. Now you can say, oh, okay, that's interesting, but it's still very specialized, right? This is with arithmetic and stuff and sort of procedural things that we need to do in school. But it also is applicable, this method of finding these sort of general knowledge structures of sort of much more everyday things. So here's another example. It's actually, these are two sort of tasks from psychology. The first one is the so-called Stroop task. You might have seen that one before. You see a word and it has a color of ink, and your task is to name the color of the ink. So in this case, you have to say red. You have to ignore the fact that the word actually says green. Now, this is something that people need a little bit of focus on to do well. And people are typically also a little bit slower on saying red here than when the word itself would also have been red. Another paradigm from psychology is called task switching. What you see is a sequence of numbers. And sometimes you have to say whether the number is odd or even. And sometimes you have to say whether it's a large or a small number, so greater than 5 or smaller than 5. And it turns out that if you have to switch from one task to the other, that people have some trouble with that. They're slightly slower because they have to sort of switch gears in their mind. So if we draw these networks and we look for the overlap, well, the overlap is much smaller here than in the multi-column arithmetic, but it is a very critical piece of overlap. So if we analyze what is the overlap here, it turns out that that knowledge is about preparation, about being ready for something that is still going to happen. And being ready for something that is still going to happen is a very important skill. But it's something that we need to pick up. And this is, well, you can train on these sort of psychological tasks, but of course, in many different everyday tasks, you need to anticipate the future. And that's a common skill. And that's a really useful skill for humans. So what we can do with this method is find various sort of common strategies in a human knowledge, because those are the building blocks of intelligence. So we have seen multi-column arithmetic, we have seen sort of focusing on something, preparing for something. So you might say, like, I prepare to call, to say the color of the ink, so I sort of try to mentally blur out the letters. There are methods of integrating multiple pieces of information. And there's one sort of example I want to go into a little bit more, and that's what we call theory of mind. And theory of mind means we think about the goals, the knowledge, the personality of another person. Now, this is actually something that is also very important in the three examples I showed you at the start of the presentation. Playing games with other people, you have to sort of think about what that other person. If you have a self-driving car, you need to anticipate the other traffic. And it turns out that's very hard for machines. But we somehow sort of try to isolate that skill and build a sort of example computer program around it. And it's one where you can negotiate with. So we have a computer program. It's called Meta, and it's part of the EU project called Metalog. And you can negotiate with it about, in this case, about a smoking ban. So we both want to have a smoking ban, but we have different ideas about it. So I might think, like, I want a 10% tax increase, and I want big billboards with anti-smoking advertisements. But my computer opponent might have a slightly different idea, like, well, 5% tax increase is enough, and I want television advertisements instead of big billboards. I think that's more efficient. So we can sort of negotiate about that, but we have to sort of think about each other when we negotiate. So I might think, like, well, maybe I strike some sort of deal and say, like, well, you get the TV ads, but I want a 10%. And this computer program will sort of try to interpret that and negotiate with me, but also think about me. So, like, thinking, like, well, that might be actually a cooperative move in negotiation to sort of try to find out a common solution. And that's what this program also tries to do. It tries to think about me. So I'll show you a very brief snippet of demo.
Would advertisements across all media be good for you?
But that would be worse for us.
If I give you 10% tax increase, would you give me television advertisements?
I can give you 5% and you give me anti-smoking posters.
Okay, this would work for me.
So very short example, it's fun to negotiate with Meta. Just about smoking yet, but we're working on other things. The important lesson here is that what I've shown you is sort of basic building blocks of intelligence. And that is what's something that computers will also need to master if we want intelligent machines. And I say if because we don't necessarily might want to have intelligent computers just as intelligent as we, but that's not a discussion I'm going to follow here. But here are some of the building blocks you can think about, sort of counting and letters and scribbling things down and focus. And we can use those to build more complex and complex things. So doing addition is based on our notion of numbers, and we can use that to do arithmetic. And then finally, building all these skills together, we might get to playing chess, being good at chess, and maybe be a mathematician. And maybe that, in the end, is the road to intelligent machines. Again, assuming we really want them. Thank you for your attention. That was it.